There's one thing, above all things, that I hate about the Atari ST more than anything. And can you guess what it is? Yes, it's the beep. So, how are we going to fix that? So the easiest way I know to disable the beep is via the control panel. This is an Atari supplied component that, like a lot of things in the GEM desktop, wasn't released with the ST, but later, almost like an afterthought, as usual, from Atari. These omissions of basic functionality from the initial system kind of underlie its roots as, I think, a game system rather than a serious desktop system. And over time, Atari did push to catch up on some of these things, but most of them were there on day one in the Amiga. And that's why we tend to get sneered at in the ST community. It's a pity. Right, so the control panel install is just a drag and drop plus configuration exercise. I'm going to pull in XControl. I'm using XControl 1.3.1. You should be able to find this very easily through a search on Google. I think there's Amiga Up to Date has a copy, but that might actually be version 1. But like I say, there are plenty of places I'll find it. I'll pop a link in below if I can. There are two XControl accessory files. There's the xcontrol.acc, which is localized to American English, and the xcontrol UKACC, which is localized to British English. We might even get a U in color. You never know. So accessories appear underneath desktop info on the desk menu. You can have up to 7 ACC files loaded at once. And they can have different functions, and the advantage of an AAC is it's loaded at startup and resident in memory. So it can actually pop up over the top of running GEM applications, and it's available inside of all GEM applications. They're really quite powerful. Post a reboot, our control panel should show up, as I said, underneath desktop info as an accessory. So I'm just going to select that, and up it pops. Pretty underwhelming, I think you'll agree, because we have no actual extensions loaded yet because it doesn't know where to find them. So I'm going to go into the options and I'm going to go setup. I'm going to come down here and I'm going to say, when you want to find your extensions, go look in this folder. And then, just so they actually get loaded and we can use them, I'm going to click this, which is going to reload the CPXs. Say yes to that. I'm going to pop a save in there, say okay. And when we come back, here we have our control panel extensions. Very nice. There's nothing important in the fact that this is a different color other than to kind of hint to you that you can change the color and display of these things as part of your customizations. But we have extensions to change colors, configure the actual CPXs, in other words, the color of the icons, color of the text, a general setup section, which we'll be hitting very soon, a mouse accelerator settings, modem settings, printer settings, and sound settings. Right, where are we going to start? We're going to start by fixing the problem that I described at the beginning and getting rid of that daft beep. If we go into general settings, we have the ability to turn off the ding-ding alarm bell and the ability to turn off the bleepy-bleepy keyboard sound. That has fixed our initial problem. I promise you, it's fixed it. But while we're in here, we can do a few other things under general. We can check version of TOS, the date, how much free RAM there is. This is using EMUTOS, so it's a relatively recent date. We can turn the blitter on or off. You can also do that, of course, from the options menu. We can select the CPU speed and reduce it to 8 MHz for compatibility. And then we can set keyboard repeat times, response rates, and then the mouse speed and our double click velocity, and none of which are really things I ever change. They all just seem fine to me. Save that. So before we go through any more of these extensions, let's just go back through the options. So here I can set my time, set my date. Another good indicator that you're using emutos, of course, is that it's really happy with dates past the millennium. We can set our time format, 12-hour or 24-hour. I'm a European, I like 24-hour time. Reload our control panel extensions, set our extensions path. Now, what this allows us to do is decide which control panel extensions are actually displayed in the UI. I'm going to make a unilateral decision. Well, it's my system, I'll do what I want. We can remove modems, because we ain't got none of them. Mouse acceleration, because I don't use it. And printer, because I don't use a printer either. Then that just leaves us with these. Under the bonnet, when you disable a control panel extension, what it's actually doing is renaming the file for a CPZ extension. So there's Mac, there's printer, and there's modem. Good. Now where are we? Again, we're going to save. We're going to OK that. And let's go through some of these choices. I'm going to leave color and window color till last. Actually, notice that my accelerator and that are still showing. So let's go into setup again. And then let's try and work out which one. Let's reload our CPXs. Go back. There they are. They're gone. Excellent. Let's go configure CPXs. So this allows us to rename them if we want to. So I could say, you know, I want to call it settings rather than setup, if that's what you want. We can change the color. We can change the text color and the icon color. Now, I'm in medium resolution mode, so I only have four colors. Obviously, if you're doing this in low resolution mode, you've got lots of colors, just not very many pixels. This option is whether you want the extension to be resident in RAM. Now, with the accessory file, the ACC file, that's always resident in RAM. I don't see that you're ever going to use any of these individual control panels often enough that you're necessarily going to want them to be resident in RAM, and especially if you're running off a hard drive, right? Because it can pull it in quickly anyway. Let's configure CPXs. General setup, we've been through, so we can ignore that. Sound setup, you can adjust master volume. It's very pretty, isn't it? You can change the left-right balance for people like me who've got a bad ear. We can increase and decrease the bass and the treble. All very good. Never used them. But finally, we're under the two color options. So color setup is in two parts. One is for the colors of actual window decorations, and the other one is like the master color setup. The way the ST works is you have four, what you might call inks, and each of those inks can be assigned any color you want. So we could make the white color be purple. I mean, that's awful, but we could do it. The reality is white and black need to be white and black because that's window and text. This is always going to be your desktop background, and that is kind of an error color, but these two are kind of flexible. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make that one my sort of favorite color, which is a pink, sort of a purpley color. I'm going to okay that. And then I'm going to quit out the control panel just temporarily because not everything is set from the control panels. But if we want to set the background of our screen, I can say, all right, it's purple. And I could change that color if I wanted to. But I made it purple for a reason. But I want it to be solid purple. Then I could go lightly speckled to fully solid. Right. Already, I think we're looking better. So let's go back to our control panel. Maybe we'll make this red a confident you feel like you know how these colors work, David. That's a kind of a yellowy orange color. It's a bit, maybe it's a bit bright. Bit of an orange color. That will do. So now we come to the real fun part of this. You can go a little bit, I wouldn't say crazy is a a very strong word, but you can actually make some fairly swinging changes using this. You can control just about the color of every part of a Windows layout, which is sort of cool. So let's concentrate on this thing. So the window title, and I want my window title to be solid color. I want the text to be white, and I want the fill to be orange. Never make an artist, will I? That's an example of a very small change. We've made that change. Let's save it. I keep pressing save. I really don't know when you have to. But now if I come into here and I open the D drive, you can see our change has actually taken place. So that's just a little splash of color on the screen. It's not really changed a lot, but it's lifted the UI, if you want to use that sort of a term. And you can change the color of most parts of it. So we could make our invisible part of the scroll bar be our orange color as well. Let's make this one the same orange color. No text associated with it. Doesn't really want to be solid. And we could, if we wished, we could make the larger part of it be filled orange. Or purple. We'll go orange. Solid fill. Solid fill. Orange. And I'm going to leave it there because otherwise you get a bit carried away with it at times. But you do you, right? Do exactly what you want to do. So original intent at the start of this video was to get rid of the beep of annoyance. So let's just verify that we've actually achieved that. And we have, which is marvelous. The alarm I might turn back on at a later date because, you know, with things like text editors, it does give you an indication that you've made a mistake. But unfortunately, in the control panel, there's no way to actually control the volume of that sound other than to lower the actual main system volume, which is just unfortunate. There are more control panel extensions available other than the ones that Atari ship. Yeah, it was an example here. We're on the Atari ST Essential Software list, and here is a control panel extension that is a calculator. I shan't try to pronounce that. I really don't speak German. We can download and install this, so let's do that. I already have downloaded it. So here is the CPX file. Stick that into my control panel extensions folder. Open up the control panel. I'm going to reload my CPXs, so it appears. Here at the bottom of the list will appear my calculator. If I run that, we can do an experiment. What is 63335 as a hexadecimal number? Kel surprise, it's FFF. Square root should be FF. Everything is working. It's a programmer's calculator. And that's, you know, an advantage of having it as a CPX, in that you can have that load in over the top of a gem app. So you can have it load in over the top of your C IDE or your Pascal IDE. There are plenty of these calculators, by the way, out there that are ACC files, which would appear in this list here, that you could then just click directly. So you might ask yourself, why one click versus two click? Well, you're limited to 7 slots in this menu. And so, you know, you may run out of them. And if you have too many, they will just get dropped on the floor. But there is no limit on the CPX files that I'm aware of anyway. So you can free up slots by using them through CPXs. So I think it's time to call it a day for this recording. We've covered quite a bit of ground in this in a short period of time. We've learned about accessories and control panels, control panel extensions, how to install them, how to find and install third-party ones, and how to make your desktop look a little bit prettier than it does by default. So that's it for now. Thanks for watching, and talk to you soon.